In a village in La Mancha, whose name I prefer not to recall, there lived not long ago a member of the petty country nobility who always has a lance in the rack, an ancient shield, a skinny nag, and a greyhound for coursing.
My lord! Oh! A machine from hell! The monster has kidnapped the princess! But I shall free her, Sancho!
Wait, sir. Don't let the devil deceive you. It's only a vespa.
Stop, you scoundrel! My lady, I will free you from this evil machine. Release the lady you kidnapped immediately.
Oh, God. Who is this lunatic?
Don Quixote de la Mancha, knight errant and slave of the peerless and fair Dulcinea.
You're in my way. Just get out of there.
What is his servant called?
Sancho Panza.
Ah, well, thought it was something like that. Right. Excuse my ignorance.
Are you trying to be funny with the police?
No, I'm just trying to convince you, sir, that I don't know him.
What's that?
I don't know this rogue Don Quixote. I swear I don't.
Do you know a man named Don Quixote? Scarecrow of a man with a lance. Making trouble everywhere. He must be here. I saw his horse outside. And he's always with a fat fool whose name is Sancho Panza.
Lo español es la combinación de Don Quixote y Sancho.
Somos más bajos. Entonces yo soy Sancho. Sí. Sí, sí, hay más Sancho que Quixote, sí.
Why has it given rise to so many images? It's the most fascinating, mysterious text in literature. Probably one of the two, three.
This is a film about two of the most famous characters in fiction, who've been traversing the world's cultural landscape for almost 400 years. Ironically, however, the fame of this great literary duo has been spread more through films, paintings, sculptures, illustrations, orchestral suites, operas, ballets, and musicals than through a reading of Miguel de Cervantes' original novel, still considered to be the world's most translated work of fiction.
There is this immense descendance of Don Quixote, I think, throughout literature. One could not understand the history of the novel without Cervantes. We come directly from Don Quixote, we know it. It is a book I read every year. Around this time of the year, I'm soon going to begin my yearly reading of Cervantes, of Don Quixote. I do it around Easter. I think it's a good Easter reading. And of course, we would not write in our language. We would have no Spanish language, no literary language in Spanish without Cervantes and Don Quixote.
Y así se le pasaban las noches leyendo de claro en claro, y los días de turbio en turbio. Y del poco dormir y del mucho leer se le secó el cerebro, de manera que vino a perder el juicio.
Don Quixote is first presented by Cervantes as a ridiculous figure, who comes to believe that the novels of chivalry he so loves are real. But what began as a short satire on a form of fiction popular at the time grew to become the world's first psychological novel. Don Quixote always refers back to books of the past, yet his fictional life is still regarded as the most modern of novels.
It is the most modern of novels because it presents us with a perpetual quandary, which is that of leaving our village, leaving our home, going out of ourselves and discovering the world. Of course, in Cervantes' novel, this is done within a very specific historical, religious, moral context, which is that of the end of the Middle Ages and the beginning of what we call the Modern Ages. But Don Quixote comes from a world which is essentially unified and goes out into a world where nothing is what it seems. He read books that he wants to see, but reality denies him this possibility. There is a divorce between words and reality.
It's not a book. It's almost a continent. It's a place you disappear into. And you find that in reading the book, you're reading your life backwards, as well as reading all literature backwards. I think that was extremely enlightening and frightening at the same time. Because I found myself reading it. I read it on tubes and buses, in fields, in friends' houses. I read it very slowly. And so it wove its way into my life and my experiences, my ups and my downs, my miseries and my triumphs. I found that as I read it, I was reading almost every important Western text of the last 200-300 years.
It's really through the imagination of other authors to whom Don Quixote has meant an enormous amount that the figure of the knight of the mournful countenance has begun to haunt the background of my own imagination. I think my deepest relation to Don Quixote is in fact Borges's essay on Pierre Menard, the man who wrote The Modern Quixote, because then I suddenly saw it fell into place, Don Quixote, as the book in some ways about imagination being realer than reality and every age rewriting in good ways and bad ways the texts of the past.
Quijotes italianos, Quijotes franceses, Quijotes alemanes, Quijotes japoneses e incluso Quijotes españoles, que ya realmente lo más insólito que haya los propios Quijotes, y también vemos aquí Quijotes iberoamericanos. Es decir, que todo ello se haya vuelto papel, tipografía, el amor artesanal por los libros, y que sea siempre el mismo texto. Yo recuerdo siempre, en los años que viví en Buenos Aires, esa amistad privilegiada con Borges, el autor de ese texto maravilloso que se llama Pierre Menard, autor del Quijote. ¿Y qué es eso? Un hombre que reescribe el Quijote con las mismas palabras del Quijote en diversas épocas. Y ese texto es el mismo y distinto para cada uno de nosotros. Y aquí en mitad de La Mancha, de Castilla, donde la gente juega cartas y pasa las horas de la siesta en su bar, está aquí Don Quijote, donde precisamente es donde más pueden existir las quimeras y las fantasías. No creo que haya realmente una figura que se haya vuelto tantas imágenes y que a la vez no sea ninguna imagen, sino cada lector es Don Quijote. En ese sentido, Borges escribió en Buenos Aires hace algún tiempo solo cuatro líneas que dicen así: crueles estrellas y propicias estrellas presidieron la noche de mi génesis. Debo a las últimas la cárcel en que soñé el Quijote. A veces hay estrellas favorables, positivas, benévolas con la gente, que le permiten crear grandes obras que van mucho más allá del tiempo, que sobrepasan el tiempo. Y en las posadas, en las tabernas, en los bares, sigue existiendo el Quijote.
As he journeyed along the road, our knight continued to talk to himself, saying, fortunate the age and fortunate the times in which my famous deeds shall come to light. Deeds worthy to be engraved in bronze, carved in marble, and painted on wood as a memorial for posterity. And you, sage enchanter, whoever you may be, to whose lot it falls to be the chronicler of my strange history, I beg you not to forget my good Rosinante, my constant companion on all my rides and journeys through La Mancha.
I think we can agree to some extent that La Mancha is a state of mind. And it's a state of mind that everybody wants to bear witness to. And so you can walk down Putney High Street and find La Mancha. The need to fix it in forms, the need to draw it out from words into the real world is very strong.
O sea, son momentos del libro y que a mí como lectora y como escritora también, pues me parecen particularmente satisfactorio tenerlos aquí en la casa. Es muy difícil ver hasta qué punto Don Quijote me ha influido, es muy difícil. es un personaje tan potente, y lo he leído tantas veces yo, el Quijote, que es como la forma de escribir el personaje, creo que está tan dentro de mí que no soy capaz de decir de qué manera me ha influido. Ojalá me hubiera influido. Lo que puedo decir es que me encantaría que se notara que soy lectora del Quijote.
¡Mira, Sancho! ¡Contempla lo que tenemos ahí delante! La fortuna va guiando nuestras cosas mejor aún de lo que deseáramos, porque ves allí, amigo, más de 30 desaforados gigantes. Ahora mismo pienso entrar en batalla con ellos y quitarles las vidas para enriquecernos con sus despojos y arrebatarles sus reinos. Don Quijote.
Curious experience with the adventures, in the sense that when I'm reading them, I feel let down. I feel I have known this image all my life of someone tilting at windmills. When you actually read it, it seems to be almost nothing.
Dijo a su escudero, la aventura va guiando nuestras cosas mejor de lo que acertaremos a desear, porque ves allí, amigo Sancho Panza, donde se descubren 30 o poco más.
And what had seemed to be a simple, slightly banal, slightly absurd incident has become legendary during even the writing of the book of Don Quixote.
Son molinos. Son gigantes. Socorredme, señora mía Dulcinea.
They take on this kind of phantasmagoric importance as fictive events.
I believe in the people. I laugh at thee and thy wickedness. Faith, hope and charity conquers all. Thy plots and persecutions will avail thee nothing. Long live humanity! Avaunt, evil one!
Everyone reads the Molinos in high school. I read the Molinos again in college, all in English. It wasn't until Spanish, until an upper-level Spanish class that we read this, but yeah. It's something that I think we all read a little bit of in high school.
I think in high school, the only time we would read Don Quixote is in a Spanish class. It's not part of our repertoire of literature,
which is too bad.
Yeah, I kind of think that that might be because it's so much about failure. And it might be significant that your country's most popular version is the musical, Man of La Mancha.
Well, I especially think the way that the Man from La Mancha has twisted the story and turned it into this glorious romantic to dream the impossible dream. We don't, and we read the Molinos and we laugh at Don Quixote and think what a fool, and don't go beyond that and don't talk about that, the contrast between reality and illusion and that whole conflict. That,
like you were saying, that it makes a hero out of Don Quixote instead of a tragic figure.
I am I, Don Quixote, the Lord of La Mancha.
Well, the next piece of music is another show tune.
And this is from the Man of La Mancha, and it's The Impossible Dream. I saw that having returned from Vietnam from my first tour. My mother always used to love to take me to stage shows, and we went to New York to see this. At that time, there was a great deal of confusion in my mind, because I knew why I had been in Vietnam, and I came back to this ambivalence and questioning of it, and that, of course, caused me to question what it was all about. And when I heard this song, I just said, that's why.
It's all right, the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right, without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart will lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest.
Cervantes and Don Quixote now find themselves on either side of a new European coin. An ironic twist of fate for an author whose own life was a hard struggle for survival, much of it spent earning a pittance as a tax collector. Cervantes spent much of his life on the move. He lost a hand at the Battle of Lepanto, spent 5 years in a Moorish jail, helped organize provisions for the Spanish Armada, and was over 50 when he published the first part of Don Quixote in 1605, the same year as King Lear and Macbeth. Indeed, Cervantes and Shakespeare died within the same week in 1616. Don Quixote may be about failure, but the novel was an immediate success, and its two central characters soon an instantly recognizable icon.
Don Quixote is easy to visualize because he is so clearly drawn by Cervantes, the tall, lank, idealistic man, and the tiny, chubby, down-to-earth peasant character next to him, two aspects of the human soul.
Esta es la tierra de Cervantes, Guanajuato, capital del cervantismo en América. Por eso el Museo del Quijote está aquí. Esta es la tierra de Guanajuato, donde Cervantes es familiar, donde Don Quijote cabalga por sus calles. Ese es el gran homenaje que se debía a Guanajuato y el que le hemos tributado. Este museo es lectura visual del Quijote. Porque lo que hemos querido es que, aparte de que los grandes artistas contemporáneos representen al Quijote, estén en el Quijote todas las escuelas plásticas de interpretación, desde el arte popular artesanal a las grandes realizaciones de los grandes maestros de la pintura. Del arte italiano, de Inglaterra, de Polonia, de Checoslovaquia, figura como este Platón chino del siglo XVIII, donde, como sucede en todas las interpretaciones del Quijote, cada país trata de identificar con el prototipo nacional al Quijote. Es que yo estoy en un campo de concentración y tengo como único libro de lectura en el campo de concentración Don Quijote de la Mancha. Entonces, 18 meses tumbado en un campo de concentración, viendo morir a la gente y yo leyendo el Quijote, entonces eso deja una fijación espiritual, anímica, definitiva en la vida.
Hicieron la serie en la televisión del Quijote. A raíz de ahí, digamos que yo me inspiré un poco. Al verlo en la televisión, la serie, me inspiré un poco en... Por eso lo dibujo siempre en plan de dibujos animados. Sancho es el personaje que más se identifica con el carácter manchego. Digamos que es un señor inculto, se mueve un poco por los intereses, piensa en comer, y luego físicamente es que es muy manchego. Los manchegos son todos bajitos y gorditos, todos. Lo mismo las mujeres que los hombres. Entonces, digamos que me encaja mucho más Sancho que Don Quijote. Yo me imagino que Miguel de Cervantes, como viajó mucho a través de España, pues bueno, cogió a Sancho por lo manchego. Y Don Quijote, bueno, pues a lo mejor es el personaje central y digamos que para interesar un poco más y a lo mejor impactar más.
Lo tengo en mi casa, el libro, pero no lo he leído. Pero aquí
tenemos
compañeros
todos, y... El libro lo tenemos pues, sí, casi sabe, todos. Los de Castilla-La Mancha casi todos.
Tenemos el Quijote en casa,
hay quien
pero...
lo lee más o hay quien lo lee
en
menos.
En España pero... es que se lee bastante poco. Entonces yo ya te he dicho antes que no lo había leído y lo tengo en casa.
¿Pero usted lo ha leído?
Soy muy curioso yo leyendo. Abro el libro y donde me parece allá. Tampoco lo he leído a corte.
Don Quijote and Sancho were lodged in a grand room hung with paintings. You know, I bet, said Sancho, that before long there won't be a wine house, a tavern, or a barber's shop where there'll not be paintings commemorating the history of our exploits.
Es que da uno viejo.
Yo.
My weapons. Sancho, do you see that cloud of dust? It's a huge army.
Armies, you mean? Here, two clouds.
Generations in the future will remember this day. Don Quixote will give absolutely no quarter to those who dare challenge him. Sancho, listen, the noise is deafening. That army is led by the bravest of men, Lora Calco, and the other by the fearsome Micocolembo, for Dulcinea!
Can't you see that they're only lambs?
For Dulcinea!
Coward!
The comedy is male, and I, as a woman, experience it as brutality and violence and people having their teeth knocked out and people having their ribs beaten in, and the good people knock the teeth out and beat the ribs in. And Don Quixote is actually, in my, you know, not charming. He will advance on anybody and hit them with the lance without asking who they are or what they are at the natural level.
It's a tremendous amount of pain. It's a book in which he gets beaten, he gets kicked about, he keeps being wounded, he gets savaged by sheep, by human beings, by bandits, by set upon by robbers, and all the time he's living in an enchanted state. Because all of this pain, and this is what is extraordinary about this book, everything that he suffers is filtered through an enchanted condition of actually perceiving it as something other.
I fear my history will need a commentary to be understood, said Don Quixote. No, came the reply. Your history is so plain, there's nothing in it to raise any difficulty. Young people read it, grown men know it by heart, and old men praise it. It's so dog-eared, in fact, your history, so familiar to all sorts of people, that whenever they see a lean horse go by, they cry, there goes Rosinante.
Señor, una venta. Podremos descansar nosotros y las bestias.
Now this particular place symbolizes the meeting place where the travelers met and they exchanged histories and stories. So it was sort of the literary resource for making people, you know, meet a particular place. That's why this is so symbolic in the novel. Well, Don Quixote is the first modern novel, and it's the prototype of the Spanish literature and the Siglo de Oro, the Golden Century. It was a big force behind the development of Spanish literature.
La venta quizás es algo que no se conoce ahora mismo, si no es en el ambiente de Castilla, que es donde se conservan ventas, ¿no? Y hay un paralelismo en el Quijote entre lo que es un castillo y lo que es la venta. Castillos hay por todas partes, hay un patio de armas, y aquí se ve perfectamente que esa equivocación de Don Quijote era posible.
Para mí ha sido una experiencia extraordinaria porque no había estado nunca en una venta y esta experiencia, música culta, hablar de Cervantes, ver que entra la gente en la venta, aunque no se venga a caballo ni a mulo, pero es el punto de llegada de la gente que entraba, que escuchaba, ha sido una experiencia muy bonita esta mañana. Capítulos de los textos.
¿Dos veces?
Más.
Sí. Es un libro muy importante para usted.
Sí, además yo soy manchego. Es
como el queso.
Es imposible no verlo. Sí. Lo que yo recuerdo, más importante para mí, es que el lenguaje del Quijote es el mismo castellano que hablaba mi abuela. Es una cosa muy personal. Y bueno, sobre todo el lenguaje.
Fantasía y lo real. ¿Quién está loco y quién no? La mentalidad probablemente sea común a todos. Esté dentro del carácter general de lo hispánico, no sé.
Surely these are the outskirts of El Toboso.
Are you sure this is such a good idea, Master?
What says Sir Sancho? Is not El Toboso the home of my lady, which I have me take no leave, of she who holds my captive heart?
The next morning, Sancho set off on his mission to bring the Lady Dulcinea to his master.
Fail me not, faithful squire.
Fear not, master. I'll bring her to you.
Without having any idea where he would find such a woman, or if indeed she even existed.
Anyone out there got any bright ideas? No? What a mess. Wait a minute. This man thinks inns are castles, and barber's basins are magic helmets. Your Grace, she comes.
Verily?
Absolutely, verily. You can't miss her. She's on a white horse.
Caparisoned in red leather.
That's the one, attended by two handmen.
Mounted on grey palfreys.
Whatever, they're gorgeous.
Lead me to her.
Hombre, yo hoy en día no se puede ser Dulcinea, porque para superar a esa mujer es imposible.
Pero no es un divertido que Dulcinea, pues más o menos no existió, ¿no?
No, no existió. Este señor Cervantes estuvo viviendo por esta parte, ¿no? Topa en esos personajes y en gente de ese pueblo.
La mujer de Tomás es hermosa, pero tampoco se puede comparar con Dulcinea porque siempre ha sido un mito y entonces no, nunca se va a poder comparar a ella.
It's a great love story because, of course, we all know that the paramour of Don Quixote, Dulcinea del Toboso, is not really the high-ranking princess he says. She's a lowly peasant girl who smells of garlic, who can bellow with a strong voice to bring the cows home, who is of rather loose virtue. And the extraordinary thing is that in the second part of the book, we discover that Don Quixote knows all of this. Sancho comes with, says, she's not Dulcinea, she's Aldonza Lorenza. He says, I know who she is. But I'm in love with her, and therefore I see her the way my eyes, the eyes of a lover, see her. And the social difference, he adds, is of no consequence whatsoever.
Goodness, it's one of the most beautiful, one of the purest, one of the most heartbreaking love stories in the world, precisely because it is not directly about love, it's obliquely about love. And it comes back to this central point again of what is love? When you love somebody, what do you love? Do you love the person in total objectivity, which is almost impossible? Or do you love them through the filter of your own dreams, your own imaginings, your own idealization? Or is it the meeting of both?
I mean, that tune sort of haunts us all the way through, doesn't it? This sort of love for Dulcinea.
It haunts us and it is repeated often enough so that it becomes a successful tune,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
Like Weber.
Yeah, I mean, at least 2,000 people leaving the Colosseum humming it. The use of the book is extremely free and cavalier. I think Massenet was interested in writing an opera rather than being lit by the spirit of the novel. I confess to some embarrassment over the character of Dulcinea at the moment, in that consistently she seems to be running a rather grand 4 or 5 star hotel, don't you think?
Mm.
I think very few people have actually taken the story as it's written. I mean, most people who've made versions of it have changed it to quite a big degree.
So maybe that's the inspirational quality.
Yes, I think it's a story
of
which is...
Of the knight himself.
Yes.
Oh,
And I think this is another thing that may annoy women, because I think one of the things that irritates women is the male idea of courtly love. Nobody likes to be set up on a pedestal, or a man to be in love with some other woman set up on a pedestal who is then turned into an ideal. I think most women want a reciprocal relationship in which people talk to each other.
Lo más importante en el Quijote es la creación personal de la fantasía por encima del amor, ¿no? O sea, que no hay un... el Quijote no vale solo para los hombres, vale también para las mujeres. Pero efectivamente, como creación amorosa, nos podría servir igualmente, nos podríamos crear las mujeres un Don Quijote, como una Dulcinea, que es la contrapartida del héroe, ¿no? Dentro del Quijote hay un personaje que es muy interesante, que es una mujer, que es Marcela, que es una pastora, que vive fuera de la sociedad de los hombres. Ella ha renunciado y vive en su mundo, ¿no? Esta es una mujer que podía ser heredera también del espíritu del Quijote.
I know by the natural sense which God has given me that whatever is beautiful is lovable, said Marcella. But I do not understand why, merely because she inspires love, a woman who is loved for her beauty is obliged to love the man who loves her. Besides, it may chance that the man who loves what is beautiful is himself ugly. And as ugliness is loathsome, it would be absurd for him to say, I love you for your beauty. You must love me, although I am ugly.
I think it's a challenge towards trying to live your life as you want, imagining things as you want them to be, and versus the people that live just picturing reality all the time. And I think sometimes you have to imagine things to enjoy it most.
Do you identify more with Sancho or Don Quixote?
I think I'm more like Don Quixote.
A dreamer?
Yeah.
I was lucky enough to acquire a print by Picasso of his famous painting. It's in my lounge. It's the, of all the pictures in my house, is the one I like the best. I can really imagine him as he was, you know, in that picture.
It's really funny to me, because one of the animals has got only three legs. Yes. And there are lots of people who bought the print and think it's absolutely wonderful. They've never counted the number of legs.
The first part, Don Quixote is more of a madman. 10 years later, Cervantes cures Don Quixote, so to speak. And I think the novel must be seen as a process towards sanity. I think the descent into the Montesinos cave is the most symbolic part of the Quixote, because he hallucinates in that part. And once he comes out of the Cueva de Montesinos, he's a different person.
Suddenly and involuntarily, I was overcome by a deep sleep, said Don Quixote. And when I least suspected it, not knowing how or why, I woke up to find myself in the middle of the most beautiful and delightful meadow. Soon there appeared before my eyes a royal and sumptuous palace or castle whose walls and battlements appeared to be formed of clear, transparent crystal.
I love the image of the Don descending into the cave of Montesinos. And I think it is the events and not the conversations that really stay in my mind as large legendary moments. He entered his imaginary world by an act of bravery on the end of a rope, not knowing exactly what he was going to knock into. It was a real act of bravery. I think that's what's so moving about the Cave of Montesinos.
Cervantes!
¿Conoce el capítulo sobre la cueva?
Normalmente sí lo conozco. Antes, ya como lo he leído, lo sé. Todo.
¿Entonces usted ha bajado?
Sí, y he subido. Dos cosas. Si no me va a quedar.
How long was I down, asked Don Quixote. A little more than an hour, answered Sancho. That cannot be right. Night fell there, and morning rose, and three more nights and mornings, so that by my reckoning, I must have stayed 3 days in those remote and secret regions.
And I am moved by his feeling that time had ceased for him.
The second part goes to another planet. It goes to another realm altogether. It's the second part is visionary, it's modern, it's playful, it's self-referential, it's a dancing book, it's a revelatory book, it's a book about, it becomes a book about politics, about leadership, it's a book of proverbs, a book of wisdom, a book of laughter, a book of reversals. Sancho Panza becomes Don Quixote, and Don Quixote becomes Sancho Panza.
Servido, señor Don Quixote. Y ahora deme el gobierno de la ínsula que hemos ganado en esta rigurosa batalla. Ha sido una gran victoria. Porque hemos ganado, ¿verdad?
Sí, Sancho.
Pues la ínsula, señor. Que yo me siento con fuerzas para gobernarla, por muy grande que sea.
Estas aventuras, hermano Sancho, no son de ínsulas, sino de encrucijadas. Y lo único que se saca es la cabeza rota.
And Sancho becomes a governor of a rather non-existent island. I mean, it's just a joke governorship, which he proceeds to sort of execute with perfect Don Quixotean idealism.
This town where I'm standing is called Alcalá, which is an Arabic word. And these are the remains of what was once a fine castle. This is the space that Cervantes elevated to literary glory by turning it into an island, the Isla Barataria, of which he made Sancho the governor. And that episode, one of the finest episodes in the novel, gave Cervantes the opportunity to talk about power, politics, and the nature of the relations between a ruler and his people.
It was then that Sancho, with all his attendants, arrived at a town containing about 1,000 inhabitants, who came out to receive him with a great deal of pomp.
Ahí está el año, el siglo que fue. Siempre le llevo.
Ah, se pone la fecha. En el año 42. En 1942. Alcalá de Ebro, in this town, Cervantes situated the island of Barataria, seat of the government of Sancho Panza, and scene of the famous episode, the immortal book, the ingenious knight Don Quixote de la Mancha. ¿Y dicen que Cervantes vino aquí? ¿Que estuvo aquí en este pueblo? ¿Usted considera que Sancho Panza había sido un buen gobernador? Sí. ¿Por qué lo dice así?
Porque era muy pequeño.
Hay que ser pequeño para ser gobernador.
Sí, señor.
¿Como el generalísimo?
Porque el que tiene buena barriga, un gobernador puede comer mucho.
El anterior jefe de Estado. Sí. ¿Se está refiriendo al generalísimo?
Sí, pues sí. ¿Shall I tell you why a man this ass? Because he is small. Had I a horse, I'd have been above you. Too high to give heed to your complaints, but like this I come among you nearer to your level. Here am I, and there is the ground. And all around are you, my subjects.
Justice, my lord governor. Justice, justice.
Making Sancho a governor was just one of many subtle devices which Cervantes deployed to voice social, political, and religious criticisms which could not be directly stated at the time.
And I like to think that it was here, shortly after that episode, that Sancho met an old neighbor of his, Ricote. Ricote was a Moor, a converted Moor. They were known as Moriscos, which was a pejorative term. And at the beginning of the 17th century, the king of Spain, Philip III, expelled the Moriscos en masse. There were probably, I think, about 400,000 of them. I'm not sure exactly how many. And it was a great injustice. And Ricote, Sancho's neighbor, went to various countries in Europe, went to Germany. And this episode that Cervantes introduces enables him to say a lot of things about injustice, cruelty, between the lines, of course, because Cervantes is the greatest ironist of all time, and it's a very ironic book, so you've always got to be aware of the different readings, aware of what's between the lines. And Ricote, for example, this Moor, who's been thrown out of his own country, says, you know, we were all terrible people, we deserve to be thrown out. The king has done just the right thing, a wise king. He says, it was divine inspiration that moved his majesty to adopt such wise measures. Ha, ha, ha. I mean, you've got to read between the lines. It's impossible that Cervantes could have been in favor of that massive injustice. And just down, a few lines down on the same page, Ricote says, wherever we are, we weep for Spain. For after all, we were born here, and this is our native country. And of course, it was their native country. They were as Spanish as Sancho Panza and the old Christians.
The stories within stories, the stories that creep into the main narratives, the tantalizing hints in various mirrors. The second part is unbelievable. I often wonder about whether ideas are modern or not. I just think that originators, certain creative spirits, who go for the playful side of their genius, they're always modern. Because modernity always comes from the playful side of the spirit.
Is there any particular aspect of the book, or particular chapter, or thing which has particular resonance for you, or is it the totality?
For me, the discovery when the bachelor Sansón Carrasco tells Sancho that the book Don Quixote is circulating, and it tells all their adventures, and he tells this to Don Quixote, and they find out that everything that went on before them is now read, and I think it is Sancho who says, "My God, but before only God knew these things, what happens in the interior of my soul, now everybody knows what I say, what I think." This is the great democratic revolutionary aspect of the book, that now what before only God knew, now anybody who goes into a bookshop and buys a book can know. And finding this out makes Don Quixote change his route, go to Barcelona, and become the first character in fiction who enters a printing shop. And therefore he enters the place where he is being produced.
Don Quixote had never before seen any printing, and longed to know how it was done. So he went in and saw them drawing off the sheets in one place, correcting the proofs in another, and setting up the type in a third. Further on, he saw them correcting another book, and when he asked its title, they replied that it was about that ingenious gentleman, Don Quixote de la Mancha.
The most unusual version of the novel has recently been produced by this printer. He set himself the quixotic challenge of making a meticulous, handwritten translation of the complete work based on a numerical alphabet of his own invention.
De los de Lanza en Astillero, Adarga Antigua, Rocín Flaco y Galgo Corredor.
¿Pero por qué en un cripto que nadie puede entender?
Bueno, se trataba de hacer una obra original, una obra única, distinta a todo lo que se ha hecho. Se han hecho muchas reproducciones y bueno, pues pienso que es algo distinto, que es obra original, algo inédito. Esto se trata de una ilusión de niño, de... Bueno, pues una idea que tienes.
¿Y cuánto tiempo llevó para hacerlo?
He tardado en hacerlo 122 meses. Y yo calculo, quedándome un poquito corto, que me ha llevado algo más de 20.000 horas hacerla. Como cada letra se compone de dos números, pues lleva el doble. Por lo tanto, el texto aumenta.
If you think Don Quixote is crazy and we are sane, said one of Sancho's neighbors, we ought at least to consider, who is more crazy? The one who is so because he can't help it, or the one who does crazy things because he chooses to?
Ha ha ha!
You know, Dostoevsky wrote perhaps the best review, the best critique ever written of Don Quixote, and he says it is the most melancholy of all books. It is the book of a failure. It is the story of a disillusionment, he says. It is also, to see the other side of it, Dostoevsky said, the greatest work of fiction ever written, because it proves that in fiction, truth is saved by a lie, which I think is the best definition of fiction ever given. Such a distance between what we desire and what we have in the Hispanic world that you really have to hurdle over an abyss with a triple somersault in order to reach the shore of reality from the shore of the ideal or of desire. We have never been satisfied societies. We have never achieved what we have wanted. And I think that's a good thing. Smugness, self-satisfaction, I think, is the death of the spirit.
Este cuadro rompe todos los moldes de interpretación del Quijote. Es el Quijote cosmogónico, es el Quijote cósmico. Es un Quijote universal, traído de la tierra y proyectado desde la tierra al cielo. En la escuela mexicana de interpretación de pintura del Quijote es muy sensible la tendencia a ver al Quijote como una figura mística, casi religiosa. Pero, por ejemplo, aquel mural es la revelación del Quijote como el Quijote guerrero, el Quijote Cristo, el Quijote Cervantes, el Quijote hambriento, el Quijote vengador, el Quijote triunfador. Todo esto y enfrentándose a los males de nuestro tiempo, que son las guerras, las pestes y las fuerzas del mal. Yo vivía en mi casa con esta capilla, tenía ese privilegio. Este es el Parnaso, donde llegan los personajes del Quijote, son recibidos por los ángeles y por las grandes figuras del Renacimiento español.
I deceived you, Sancho. There is no island for you.
Master.
Bear the weight of the man who has fought to relieve human distress unending. One who has seen the era of chivalry.
Generation after generation of writers and painters and filmmakers and singers and people have focused the world through Don Quixote. And there is a very important sense in which he is very much more real than I am. And he will certainly outlast me. He will continue to be there when I am dead and nobody might remember me.
Well, yes, and I think that Don Quixote is more real than the majority of the people I know, certainly.
Which is why you enjoy reading it every year.
To come into contact with reality, I read him every year. Yeah.
It's one of the most realistic books I know, precisely because it's such an imagined book, and it's a book about how the living flesh, in living, has to live through the imagination in life itself. If you take away the quality of the faculty of imagination, life would be unbearable.
Todos los que estamos en el bar, todos los que estamos en la calle, todos seguimos siendo Don Quijote. Yo creo que está muy bien que el Quijote esté entre el ruido, entre el bullicio, entre el desorden que la vida da y que el libro se enriquece cada vez más con ese desorden.
piensas que Don Quijote es una metáfora para la vida de Cervantes?
Pienso que Cervantes es Don Quijote, no es una metáfora. No necesita metáforas, él es Don Quijote, eso es lo importante, ¿no?
Night never eat, night never sleep. We do great things all day and keep from harm away. Oh, what a life without my wife. No matrimonial chain, and in the end I gain. Oh, island sweet, with lots to eat. Old wine, fresh fowl, and steak enough to make you ache. Won't that be fine when all that's mine? No hunger and no thirst for King Sancho the First.
Do you know a man named Don Quixote?